we begin with Andrew Park, who is with us from the Green Party. Dr. Andrew Park, born and raised by a single mother in Grimsby, UK, and has been a Canadian citizen for 25 years. Andrew holds a Bachelor of Science in Biology from Simon Fraser, other degrees, Master's PhD qualifications from the U of T, University of Toronto, specialist in forest ecology and adaptation to forest to climate change. Andrew is currently an associate professor of ecology at the University of Winnipeg. Andrew's research and work have taken him to four continents and all over Canada. He's a member of the Skeena Roundtable for Sustainable Development, a rural development volunteer with Rural University Services Canada, a member of the Mayor's Environmental Committee, board member of the Manitoba chapter of the Canadian Parks and Wilderness Society. In addition to being the Green Party candidate in Winnipeg South Centre, he is environment critic for the Green Party of Canada. Please welcome Andrew Park. Robert-Falcon Ouellette, coming from the Red Pheasant First Nation in Saskatchewan, raised in Calgary. Robert-Falcon moved to Winnipeg in 2010, quickly earned a reputation as a diligent community advocate working to bridge racial and economic divides. Robert-Falcon was a program director for the Aboriginal Focus Programs at the University of Manitoba, where he was a Research Council-funded researcher on education and the issues of identity. He is passionate about addressing and solving inner-city issues, city planning, and transit. Robert-Falcon spent 19 years with the Canadian Armed Forces, retiring from full-time service as Petty Officer Second Class with the appointment of Sergeant-at-Arms in the 5th Field Ambulance in Quebec. He has also worked as a professional musician in Quebec City. Robert-Falcon holds a PhD from Université de Laval, where he published his thesis, Evaluating Aboriginal Curricula Using a Cree-Métis Perspective with Regards Towards Indigenous Knowledge. Ladies and gentlemen, Robert-Falcon Ouellette. Matt Henderson is here for the NDP. Since moving to Winnipeg 28 years ago, Matt has worked to uplift his community and provide transformative experiences for youth. He developed the CKUW radio camp for inner city youth. Well done, that's a very, very good camp. And has since created an experimental Lakes Area field course for students. He owned his own record label for 10 years and remains a strong supporter of the arts. A high school history teacher at St. John's Ravenscourt School, Matt was honored to receive the 2013 Governor General's History Award for Excellence in Teaching and the 2014 Government of Canada History Award. He has also worked at the Kidney Foundation of Canada as Patient Services Coordinator. Matt earned his BA from the University of Winnipeg, holds a Bachelor of Education from the University of Manitoba, and is working towards completing his Master's of Education. Matt and his wife, Lauren, live in Fort Garry, where they are proudly raising their children, Hannah and Joseph. Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Henderson. Moments ago, we drew to see later this evening who will wrap up and provide concluding remarks, and we did it on a draw, one, two, and three. So just so you know, Mr. Park, you'll be the third to wrap up. Robert-Falcon Ouellette will be the first to wrap up, and Matt Henderson will be the second to wrap up. So that's later this evening. Now, the questions that I'm going to read here in the longest form, all the questions have been provided. So these are questions provided by the organizers. And we have three long answer questions here to begin. And again, each candidate will have 3 minutes to answer each question and 1 minute rebuttal at the end of each question. And in this round, we will start with Andrew Park, and then Robert-Falcon Ouellette, followed by Matt Henderson, and then we'll stagger the order as we go. So question one, and by the way, the candidates have seen all the questions and were provided all the questions ahead of time, so we're expecting that they've done their homework as well. Question one, our ability to preserve a safe environment for future generations depends on our empirical understanding of the natural world. Our ability to conduct effective social programs that lower our ecological footprint and promote resilience in the face of extreme weather depends on our understanding of social behavior. Does your party support increased funding for both university-based and in-house public interest environmental and social science research? And part two of question one, is if your party formed the next government, would you allow federal government scientists to freely communicate their findings to the public? What, if any, restrictions would you apply? Andrew Park, you begin with 3 minutes, starting now.
Thanks very much, Roger. In 2011, Environment Canada scientist David Tarasek was blocked by communications officers from talking about the largest ozone hole ever found in the Arctic. In the same year, the Pearl Laboratory, tasked with measuring Arctic ozone, was shut down. The resulting hole in our ozone data was a telling metaphor for the Harper government's attitude to environmental science, which is kind of like no science, no evidence, no truth. Because the Tories really do not like environmental science. They don't like climate science. They don't like funding for climate adaptation or the basic long-term monitoring of our environment that only governments can do. And of course, they don't like to allow scientists to talk to the public, at least not without a big filter. 40 federal programs have been cut or eliminated since the Harper government got a majority. We've seen libraries in dumpsters, we've seen laboratories closed, valuable data and specimen archives have been defunded. Up to this year, Fisheries and Oceans have lost about 1,075 jobs, Environment Canada 700. Total budget for Environment Canada has been cut by about 40%. The result is rock bottom morale and the failure to even enforce such laws as do exist. To this end, the Green Party of Canada believes that we have to rebuild our scientific capacity in Environment Canada, in Fisheries and Oceans, in Parks Canada and Health Canada, and we'll dedicate $75 million a year to that purpose. Our priorities include restoring habitat protection to the Fisheries Act, restaffing the Ocean Contaminants and Marine Toxicology Program, reversing cuts to the Canadian Coast Guard, particularly in emergency responses and spill prevention, restoring the Navigable Waters Protection Act and reversing cuts to climate adaptation programs. We will direct the Clerk of the Privy Council to elevate core scientific activities over the politicized management culture of the scientific civil service. For the good of the country, we have to strip away the communication barriers that prevent federal scientists talking about their work to the public. Scientists have to be free to speak about the scientific content of their work. We need to hire a chief science advisor as an objective independent officer of parliament. And finally, we need to start the long and painful process of restoring federal science libraries. But it's not going to be easy, and it's not going to happen overnight. Valuable scientists have taken early retirement. Some have left the country, such as shark biologist Steve Campana. And we need to scour the world to get those folks back. We need to appeal to those who rescued books from dumpsters to keep them safe against the time when they're needed. And that will only happen in a federal government where the culture of science and evidence is sacrosanct. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for having me here today. I really appreciate the opportunity to speak to each and every one of you and this opportunity to explain some of our environmental policies and how I think it interacts often with the social issues affecting our city, the city that we all really care about. I was thinking about some of the research that I've been conducting at the University of Manitoba for a radio show that I do. And I tried to contact at one point when I was doing this radio program, it's called At the Edge of Canada Indigenous Research. And I contacted a colleague of mine who works at the formerly Museum of Civilization, which then became the Canadian Museum of History. And after many months of negotiation with my friend, eventually he said, yes, I can do this radio interview, but you have to be very careful of the questions you ask. That's what he said in private. And he said, you have to be very careful because I'm going to have a communications officer beside me monitoring everything that I say. And so I don't want to say anything out of line with what might be official policy. And please don't ask about the new title for our museum. You know what we were discussing? It was called Traditional Indigenous Hide Tanning. Now this, perhaps for me, was not something that was very dangerous, but it is a representation of how we muzzle our scientists, how we create a system in which our scientists are afraid to share the knowledge that they have created through public funds, through public dollars. And so this, obviously for myself, needs to stop because it impedes the work of people like myself, social scientists, but it also impedes the knowledge that goes out to Indigenous communities, but also average Canadians like yourselves who should have the right to know what's going on, whether it's in the environment or in traditional hide tanning. Now, we're committed to spending $200 million more annually to create a sector-specific strategies to support innovation in green clean technologies in forestry, fisheries, mining, energy, and agriculture. We're also committed to creating Canadian research chairs, which we have at universities, which are federally funded through the SSHRC or other funding agencies, in order to look at sustainable energy technologies and development. We're also going to commit to developing a Canada Green Investment Bond that we can combine with private enterprise, but also other levels of government in order to investigate different ways of doing green technology. We're going to bring back the long form census. We're going to create the position of the Chief Science Officer, who is the Officer of Parliament and answerable to Parliament. And we're going to invest $20 billion over 10 years in green infrastructure. And I hope you'll hear that once again, $20 billion in green infrastructure so that we can deal with climate change and use science and empirically find out what's going on, and so we can actually then come to our conclusions about what we should be doing. Thank you.
And here's some of the MEP, your 3 minutes starts now.
Thanks, Andrew. Thanks for having me here. It's a real delight to be back in sort of the River Heights area. I grew up in River Heights, so it's nice to come back once in a while. As a teacher, and my big focus is on something that we call ecological literacy, where we try to ensure that the students, when they leave our care after grade 12, that they're ecologically literate. And that's where my research takes me at the University of Manitoba, where I'm trying to figure out how is it that we bridge a couple gaps? How is it that we bridge one gap that people just don't understand the science? They don't understand that there is an ecological catastrophe happening. And then two, the other gap is once we have that knowledge, sometimes we feel paralyzed to be able to do anything about it. And I think the ecologically literate person is able to jump over those gaps and to really engage. But what I try to teach my students is that we need evidence, and we need to ask questions, and from those questions come arguments. And so for me, I'm really proud to be able to say that the NDP, in terms of the first part of the question, which is in terms of funding research, that we will be providing $55 million to granting councils like NSERC and SHRC to ensure that people at the universities are able to actually do the research they need. I run into professors all over the place who are basically competing with each other and fighting with each other for valuable resources. But it comes down to social science too. And for me, it comes down to the humanities. I'm a big supporter of the humanities. And we've seen sort of the destruction of the humanities in terms of archives and museums and the shifting of museums. And I think as Canadians, we need to protect those institutions as well. The NDP have also pledged in terms of, have a pledge to unmuzzle scientists and allow them to do their work by bringing in a scientific advisory council to report to Parliament and to immediately restore the long-form census that has been devastating to so many researchers. And we want to have that back in place by 2016. And so it's not funny, it's interesting. I ran into a person who works for StatsCan, and they were trying to, they are unable to perform his or her job adequately just because there isn't enough data on who we are. And I don't think we can really develop sound legislation if we don't have that data. Thank you.
It is tragic. Governments cutting back on research, and especially on Stats Canada. If you want to even clarify further on whether there would be any limits to, because the three of you have great academic credentials, so you get this question not just from a party perspective, from a personal perspective as well. Would there be any limits on science as far as reporting to the public, even if it's completely different from government policy? 1 minute, you can address that or anything else that you've heard so far. Andrew Parker, the Greens.
Okay, well, in terms of the ability of federal scientists to talk to the public, I think it's fairly clear that they need to be able to address the scientific findings of their work. Policy is still made by governments, okay? Policy is made by governments, and it would be inappropriate for federal scientists to undermine government policy by, going outside of their expertise and, saying this policy is garbage, no matter how much they may think that. But in terms of addressing the science that your tax dollars are paid for, they should be free to speak out. And President Obama has liberated federal scientists in the USA from the yoke of the Bush years, and they're actually able to answer questions without the interposition of nine levels of communications officers. Got a lot more I can say, but I'll leave it there.
Robert-Falcon's on there. Doesn't work that way. Take a minute. Robert-Falcon, like, rebuttal. Is there anything you've heard or perhaps one question?
Well, I think when you think about scientists, I think they do need actually a certain level of freedom, especially if you have a PhD. Obviously, you're very well educated. You spend an awful lot of public dollars educating people with a bachelor's, a master's degree, and then a PhD in public institutions. And then to have them working for a public, public service. And unfortunately, I believe most scientists, whether they're social scientists or, more traditional science, they're very conservative individuals in the sense they only say what it is that their findings have said, and they don't often elaborate. They're very cautious traditionally, and you'll find that often if you listen to a scientist doing a research paper or at a conference. And so I think we should give them the full range, obviously, to speak out about issues that affect their lives, but also the Canadian public's lives and what's going on around the world. Time's up.
Matt Anderson.
Thanks very much. Yeah, I'm trying to think of an example of when that would be the case where you would actually want to stifle human progress and the challenging of ideas. I can't really come up with one as long as there are sound research questions which our scientists come up with, because we have tremendous scientific and social science and humanities contributors in this country. I was at the door, and this is not one of these made-up stories of I was at the door, but I was at the door the other day, and there was actually a federal scientist, and they wanted to go to a conference, and so they signed up for the conference, and they weren't allowed to, the government said, well, you can go, but you can't present your paper. You can't actually present your paper, but you can go. And they sort of looked at two people who are going to present their papers, well, what's the point of going if we can't present our paper? And I find that in education as a researcher, what if I present something that is counter to the norm in terms of trying to shift how we teach to teach students? Do I want to be muzzled in order to try and to move us forward and to move? I'm sorry.
You could finish your sentence.
Oh, okay, well, the bell, it's terrifying.
The cowbell is the one that's terrifying.
I'm going to wake up in the middle of the night. It's okay, I think people got the gist.
All right, thank you. It's interesting because on that, I'm very passionate about this because in my 23 years, I've seen the ability to actually call somebody directly in government, all levels of government, all political stripes. You used to be able to, get that researcher on the phone. Now it's two, three communications people, and they're at their talking points, and it's so distilled that it's almost embarrassing. And you see it that's just kind of government communication specialists. And if I ever leave the profession and go into that, boo me or whatever. Question number two. Thank you all for for those pretty clear answers. So thank you. Question number two. And again, there's a bit of a premise here, and then a couple of questions that go along with that. So question number two, and the order here for answers will be Falcon, Ouellette, Henderson, and Park. Scientifically informed international agreements to limit climate change impacts, to which Canada is a party, have concluded that global warming must be held below 2 degrees centigrade, above pre-industrial levels, with a possible tightening to 1.5 degrees. In order to have an 80% chance of meeting that 2 degree limit, greenhouse gas emissions in 2011 to 2050, that period, must be capped at a total carbon budget of 565 gigatons of carbon dioxide equivalent. You following me? This represents emissions from just 20% of the current total of fossil fuel reserves. I'll repeat that because this is an important part. This represents emissions from just 20% of the current total of fossil fuel reserves, leaving the remaining 80% of fossil reserves unburnable. What measures and targets is your party committed to introduce to ensure that Canada does not exceed its share of international targets and transitions to a low-carbon economy? As well, what measures is your party committed to introduce to enhance the resilience of our economy, infrastructure, and homes to extreme weather events entrained by global warming? And the final part of question two is, what additional measures would you personally urge your party and the federal government to pursue? Again, our order here is Falcon, Ouellette, Henderson, and Mark.
Well, when I think about climate change, I often think about my Indigenous tradition, and we often talk about seven generations, and thinking seven generations into the future about every action that we take, the impact it will have in other people behind who are coming in behind us. And so, for me though, when I think about also climate change, it's energy. How do we actually use energy? How do you go about taking energy out of the ground, or can you get that energy from other places? And we believe in the Liberal Party that climate change is real. We're not denying it, like some other parties. It is a reality, and it will have a profound impact on our lives here. We're committed to attending the 2015 December Climate Change Conference that will be happening in Paris. And when we're going there, we're intending not to delay or obfuscate or delay what is going on in those negotiations, and actually be active participants for the future, not only of ourselves, but our great-great-great-great-grandchildren. And we're also committed to convening a First Minister's Conference with all provinces and the territories and bringing people together around this question, because we believe it is very important. In Canada since 2010, we actually have a sectoral approach to climate change in the industries. Each industry does its own little thing in separation, and we believe actually what we should be doing is a more comprehensive and global approach, bringing all these sectors and industries and players together. Now, in 2009, Mr. Harper signed the Copenhagen Accord, which did cut emissions, or he said he would cut emissions by 17% below 2005 levels, to 611 gigatons, I guess, of carbon. Now, they re-signed another agreement just in May 2015, incredibly enough, to the COP21 target of 30% reduction by 2030. But instead, we're actually still on track to actually have over 727 right now, even by 2020. So we're not anywhere close to what we should be doing. And so this is why I'm very proud to announce that we are going to be investing in the future, because we believe if we delay, the costs will be enormous for our society. So we're going to be investing $20 billion in green infrastructure, creating jobs, creating an economy which is based on green infrastructure and green technology, but also investing $20 billion in trying to transition our economy from one energy force form to another in public transit, ensuring that there is an adequate form of public transit, that we don't always have to be taking our cars or using diesel and the fuel which we take up the ground, but we can actually power it with the electrical and renewable energy that we have here in the province of Manitoba, Ontario, Quebec, and British Columbia, as well as New York. And these are types of measures which I believe are going to be really very beneficial for our long-term future. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think climate change, and we can probably all agree here, is a tremendous threat, and it's the threat of the ages, and it's the threat of our lifetime. And not only will it threaten us, but it will threaten the most vulnerable, not only in Canada, in the world, and it makes things very, very unpredictable. And the unfortunate part is that our current government has been disastrous on the world stage and really tarnished our world reputation. And really sort of diminished our ability to be able to be a player at the table. In Copenhagen, it was embarrassing to see how Canada was so very disruptive there. And then in March, when they did set their new targets, it was clear that the current government has no intention to actually meeting those. And so I think the number one thing is that Canada has to become, regain its reputation on the world stage. And I think we do this in a variety of ways. And one is that we make that transition away from fossil fuels. And how the NDP want to do that is on by capping emissions. And we do have an ambitious plan to head into to Paris, where we want to cut emissions by 34% of 1990 levels. by 2025 and get that up to 80% by 2050, and ensure that the entire federation, the entire country, is on board with that. And if there are provinces that are doing amazing things, and there are provinces that are doing very progressive things that fall under that threshold, that they're able to do that as well. And I think also what we want to do is we want to ensure that we eliminate the oil and gas subsidy that we're currently giving, so that we're able to really make that transition into green energy, green technology, a green economy, and a green society, so that we can have a sustainable society. Thanks.
Andrew Park.
Okay, thank you. Unburnable carbon is the 2,860 gigaton elephant in the room. These are the proven reserves held by global energy corporations. And to keep global warming at or below 2 degrees, we've got to leave between 25 and 33% of those proven reserves in the ground. It's a truth that the Tories deny, and it's a truth that the NDP and the Liberals would prefer to ignore. NDP candidate Linda McQuaid kind of speed dated with this truth, but her campaign manager and NDP Central made sure she didn't get a second date. And within a couple of days, Thomas Mulcair was claiming that they could grow oil sands production and simultaneously reduce our carbon emissions. And as a scientist who studied these issues, I'm telling you that neither technically nor economically are these pathways feasible. What will the Green Party do? We will oppose any new pipelines or pipeline expansions that would carry diluted bitumen. Because, as Elizabeth said, in the expansionist view of the oil sands companies, it's not whether we choose pipelines or rail to transport bitumen, they're going to use both. We'll cut the $1.3 billion in indirect subsidies, cold turkey. We've had enough of this corporate welfare. It amounts to many billions over the years. The Green Party of Canada is the only party to consider the effect of carbon pricing on low-income Canadians. Our fee and dividend approach, which is explained in a handy flyer at the back, is revenue neutral. The fee, which will be imposed at the wellhead or the point of import, will be redistributed as an equal check to adult Canadians. We know that it works. British Columbia has a very similar scheme, and it has seen per capita fossil fuel use fall by 16% with no visible effect on either the economy or economic activity. We'll act to cut emissions in other sectors of the economy as well, while promoting investment in clean technology and innovation. We'll invest $6.4 billion annually, about 1% of the GST, in infrastructure renewal, and this will include installing energy retrofits on the entire existing housing stock, and that alone could save up to 12% of our current carbon emissions. We'll start a $1 billion green technology fund to smooth the path from green ideas to the marketplace, and this will help to fuel both innovation and economic diversification. And we will act to restore funding for research and practical measures to adapt to climate change to the tune of $500 million a year. Our climate plan is an integrated framework of social, economic, and science-based measures that will have a real impact on CO2 emissions.
All right, rebuttals. I think Andrew is saying to both Matt and Robert, you can't suck and blow.
I should have said that, shouldn't I?
Robert-Falcon, 1 minute.
Well, not only are there many people like yourselves who can vote, there are also many people right across this country who are very concerned about their jobs. And you know about this because there's over 68,000 jobs were lost just last month in the economy. And these individuals want work. And so what we're trying to do is use more, instead of the stick approach, where you're trying to use the carrots, in order to encourage more people to think about green technology, companies and corporations, but also governments, and using our influence in order to push people in a good direction. Now, if I think here in Winnipeg, what we should be doing, I have to think about bus rapid transit and what we should be doing and what we shouldn't be doing. Now, it's great that we have and we believe in public transportation, but is that the most efficient means to get people around the city? Is that the most important thing that we can do for the environment? What is the carbon footprint of pouring more concrete in our city? Who benefits the most? There's a study that comes out of Harvard that shows the social mobility of people is proportional to their access to a good public transportation system. And you know here in the city of Winnipeg, there are many people who need an excellent public transportation system.
Thank you. We all want to make that transition from fossil fuel dependency to greener technologies, but we can't do it tomorrow. What we're planning on doing the NDP is to be able to generate that innovation through innovation grants to ensure that we do make that transition as quickly as possible. We also know the Broadband Institute reviewed a paper by the TD Bank, and I think it's the PEMDA Institute, where we know that transition is actually going to supply most of the jobs, right? To say that the NDP is not willing to make that transition, I think is a little disingenuous, and certainly we have a robust plan, certainly with our cap and trade system, to cap emissions and ensure that we are meeting our global obligations in terms of the emissions of greenhouse gases.
Well, thank you. I've been to 5 different events now where Matt has described how ending poverty is part of the NDP constitution, which is great, but it's the Green Party that actually has policies that would achieve that goal. We've postulated a guaranteed livable income, your program, incidentally, that a number of Canadian mayors are beginning to take on board, that would ensure that no Canadian would live below the poverty line. And our fee and dividend actually adds a progressive element to carbon pricing, because the poor are potentially vulnerable when carbon is priced, including under cap and trade. And there's a lot to worry about under cap and trade. Cap and trade in Europe has failed spectacularly. The EU Observer reported in 2009 that the exchange trading system has been a magnet for tax fraud on a grand scale, costing government coffers around 5 billion euros, and it's even being investigated by Europol, Europe's Criminal Intelligence Agency. As much as 90% of the entire market volume of emissions exchanges was caused by fraudulent activity. And finally, it's potentially riddled with exemptions, and Glenn Murray of Ontario has already said he will have exemptions for as many as 20 industries.
Question number 3, and then we'll have the fun voting segment, not to say that this isn't fun. Question number 3, again, a bit of a preamble here, and then we'll get to the question. In 2012, amendments were made to the Navigable Waters Protection Act, or Bill C-45, which have left thousands of rivers and lakes without federal protection. That means that project development can occur on smaller bodies of water without first determining whether it will negatively influence the quality of the water and surrounding ecosystem. Clean water, essential to our health and ensuring the health of our waterways, needs to be a priority. In August of this year, our Living Waters, a national initiative that works together with leaders in Canada's water community, proposed that the Government of Canada set a national target of all waters in Canada in good health by 2025. Now, water is a shared need, a shared responsibility. Manitoba, fortunate to hold the 10th largest freshwater body in the world, Lake Winnipeg. Water is shared and used by people from all different backgrounds and is impacted by actions that take place across multiple jurisdictions. The question is, several parts to it. If elected, how will your party work collaboratively with other parties, other levels of government, with First Nations leaders towards the proposed target of all waters in Canada in good health by 2025? And what will your party do to ensure that clean water, water protection, and access to water will be given due consideration before enacting any other legislation that could negatively impact water? We begin with Matt.
Yeah, thanks. I think for me, water is a big issue in a number of ways, but most importantly because of my connection with the Experimental Lakes area and the students we send out there, we find that that's sort of one of the experiences. We're big on experience teachers and trying to create educative experiences that help kids make that transition to sort of being ecologically literate. And just the amazing resource we have in terms of a whole ecosystem research facility there with 59 lakes is unbelievable. And to have that being dropped by the federal government was I think, a sort of a barometer for, or was indicative of sort of what how they treated water and our waterways and our precious resource. So the NDP wants to, first of all, establish a national water strategy in collaboration with not only provinces and territories, but First Nations as well. And also that we, and this is something I'm very proud of, we want to enshrine access to water as a human right in Canada. And that to me, that's something my students talk about. My students were part of the Blue Dot movement, and that's something that they held that really, really close to their hearts. We will protect waterways and the right to navigation, protect fisheries, allow fisheries to do the work that they're supposed to do, bring back solid legislation in terms of the Navigable Waters Protections Act and also the Environment Assessment Act, so that we do have this resource and we're able to protect it for generations to come. But the path that we're on right now is disastrous, and we need to make a change.
Thank you so very much. Next up is Andrew Park.
Oil is going to be the most precious resource of the 21st century. I think there's general agreement about that. In Canada, we have a freshwater resource that's the envy of the world, but we've removed a good deal of its protection. And in certain hotspots like the Athabasca oil sands region, the province and the feds have been derelict in their monitoring of both water quality and ecological health. We need to work with the provinces, with the cities and First Nations to create a national water policy. The policy needs to aim at managing whole watersheds, protecting water sources, restoring wetlands, supporting community-based water conservation and efficiency, as well as factoring in the effects of climate change. Special consideration is needed to improve access to clean water on First Nations reserves. Shoal Lake is just the tip of a dirty water iceberg. There were 169 drinking water advisories in 126 First Nations communities in 2015. And like Shoal Lake, some of these have been in place for years, if not decades. In the next Parliament, our immediate actions must include reversing changes to the Fisheries Act, including restoring the habitat protection provisions, improving our definition of what is a harmful practice, removing exemptions from the Act for favoured industries. We need to restore protection to the majority of our lakes and rivers under the Navigable Waters Protection Act. In particular, we have to start applying this Act to pipeline crossings, which are currently exempt. We will invest $800 million a year for basic infrastructure, including housing and clean water for Canada's First Nations. We will continue our opposition to bulk water exports. These were kind of left a bit open-ended under NAFTA and maybe a threat under the Trans-Pacific Partnership. We will increase Canadian aid for access to basic water requirements and sanitation, consistent with the Millennium Development Goals. And in particular, we want to replace federal guidelines for drinking water quality with binding national standards that secure clean drinking water and human health. And of particular relevance to Lake Winnipeg, we want to establish a Canada Water Fund of $215 million for 5 years, for each year for 5 years. It'll focus on long-term watershed health, reducing runoff, pollutants and nutrients, and refunding a continued Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement. In summary, we seek to acknowledge that water is a human right. We seek to protect the fish and other organisms that live in our waters. And we seek to improve and protect water quality for both humans and ecosystems. But at the same time, I got to acknowledge that it may be a pretty tall order to have all natural water bodies in healthy condition by 2025, because some of our water bodies are under a great deal of pressure.
Robert-Falcon.
So in 2012, the federal government passed an omnibus bill, C-38, and which essentially gutted a lot of the assessment processes as well as the Fisheries Act as well as the Navigable Waters Act. And we're committed, I don't know if everyone remembers that, there was a huge outcry in the media and a lot of the public were very upset about this. And we're committed to overhauling the Fisheries Act to ensure greater protection, but also bringing back the Navigable Waters Act. And we're committed to ensuring that there is a very rigorous and scientific-based assessment process on all the assessments of any major projects that people would like to do or any corporations that would like to conduct anywhere in Canada. Now, we'd like to do this in conjunction with First Nations as well as provinces, because we believe First Nations, at the end of the day, it is their traditional territory, it is their homeland, and often many of them live there, even though they might not live here or in the city of Winnipeg. We're committed as well to increase protection of maritime coastal waters from the current 1.3% to 5% by 2017 and to 10% by 2020, meaning 10% of all maritime coastal areas will be protected in Canada. Now, this is a commitment that Mr. Harper made, but we intend to actually keep. Now, we're also committed to ensuring that all First Nations across this country have access to clean drinking water. And it was just made an announcement a month ago by Mr. Trudeau that this was part of our plan, because we believe it is a human right to have access to clean drinking water like we do have here in Winnipeg. And I love when Matt was talking about the experimental lakes assessment area. We're committed to spending the $5 billion to ensure that that important scientific research can continue to go forward, because it's part of where we can find out information about how our climate is changing by measuring what is going on within our environment and measuring the changes in some of those lakes. Thank you.
We have some time for some rebuttal now, beginning with Matt.
Sure, and some rebuttal, just sort of to press the point a bit. I think with Lake Winnipeg that Andrew brought up, we have a situation here, and most of us will probably heard on the CBC that even the other day was talking about the zebra mussel situation that we knew about. As Manitobans, we knew about it, and we failed to do anything about it. We knew they were coming, and so with Lake Winnipeg, I think it's this giant sort of beacon saying, because it's in the Hudson Bay drainage basin, that we need to have a federal government that works with not only all provinces and First Nations, but all jurisdictions of the United States, where we have such a map with so many Peas and Swift Current or Fargo that's coming into Lake Winnipeg. And we really need to be able to, if we want to save that lake, and I take Eva's point that maybe it's too far gone, but if we want to save it, I think we need a federal government that's going to really sit down with the Premiers and sit down with our American friends and say, how is it that we go about protecting this resource, even if you are not specifically dependent on it, in North Dakota or Alberta.
Andrew.
Sure.
Zebra mussels, Lake Winnipeg, and I did hear what my colleagues said, and you know what, you never give up on a water body, right? Lake Erie was declared dead, and thanks to research that was conducted at the ELA, Lake Erie actually retained aquatic health. Now, Lake Erie has also been suffering from zebra mussel infestations, and recently there's been water quality advisories in Toledo, Ohio, partially as a result of zebra mussels, because they preferentially eat some algae while leaving others alone, so they change the structure of the algal food web in the lake. But I was talking to Karen Scott, the research manager of the Lake Winnipeg Research Consortium, and she underscored that it's not about saving the lake. We have to try to manage the lake as it is. We have to try and navigate these different pressures that the lake is under. Sorry.
Robert-Falcon, Ouellette.
So one of the things that we're committed to in our assessment process is ensuring that the minister will not have any undue influence in that entire assessment process, that the minister can't start intervening at certain stages of that process during projects, whether it's pipelines or tar sands or oil sands, or even really any project that we like to think considering, but ensuring that there is, it's based on science and the public's will about what they would like to contribute, and also ensuring that we have the public, their input into these projects, not simply that it's just a panel of experts and it's only not really the people who, it's not the public will for a lot of the projects that are going forward under the current system. And so that also includes First Nation peoples and ensuring that they have the right of saying whether we should go ahead with these projects, doing full and proper consultation as it is being under the Supreme Court as well as many other court decisions. And by that I mean that if First Nations decide that they would like to go ahead with the project, then it should be our understanding that since it is their traditional territory, they would also like to have employment, that we should allow them to do so.
I was hoping for the cowbell. Thank you so very much.
I saw her reaching for it.
Yeah, no,
That's when I stopped. I started to speak too much.
Thank you all for your answers. And I know, having done stories on Lake Winnipeg and the environment for several years now, it's going to be Monday too for Winnipeg and, you know, dealing with our issues here in the city of Winnipeg and other areas. And it's going to be a lot of money that's going to have to be invested. All right, we have what I consider to be a very interesting and telling segment here. You guys want to wave your cards? No, yes, and maybe. If you want to keep track, if you want to keep score. So we have 10, actually 11 questions, because we've got a question 7 has an A and a B. And what we're going to do here is I'll ask the question, and you hold up your yes, no, or maybe. And you each can have a tight 1 minute if you want to say why your yes, maybe, or no. So here we go. Number one, and you can't put your card up until I finish the question, because that's the jeopardy. All right? So wait for the inflection in my voice. Transportation is one of the major contributors to greenhouse gases in Manitoba. It is the greatest contributor. If your party were to form government, would you make funding of public transit and active transportation infrastructure a priority? Put your placards up here. All right. Does anybody want to quickly speak to that? Andrew Park?
Sure. Transportation is huge, you know, and since I'm up here as the Green candidate, and since I biked here on the vote bike, I'm going to say it. If we're going to solve the climate crisis, we've got to get people to get out of their cars. But in order to do that, we've got to make it enjoyable to get out of their cars. We've got to make it convenient to get out of the cars. And, you know, I hate to agree with the Liberal, but I agree with what Robert-Falcon and Ouellette was saying about rapid transit and the need to consider another city, right? I think we have to be able to provide transit where it's needed throughout the city in order for people to get out of their cars and use it.
Robert-Falcon and Ouellette?
Well, we're committed to spending $20 billion. We think it's very, very important, spending it right across the country over a period of 10 years. And so the investment here in Winnipeg, I won't estimate, but I'm sure if we have some very strong members in government that we could negotiate on behalf of our constituents to talk about some of the social issues that are affecting the city and the importance of public transportation in order to bridge the great divide of our city.
Yeah, we're committed to funding infrastructure and for public transportation as well. I mean, I think what the city needs and what all municipalities need is steady, predictable funding, which really hasn't been the case in the last decade at least. For Winnipeg to really develop public transit, we really need to have the city and other municipalities within the province to be able to sort of make plans and make projections to be able to say, okay, these are our plans going forward. And the NDP is committed to doing that.
Number two, scientists find that in order to avoid catastrophic global warming, 2/3 of the known fossil fuels, including 85% of coal, 49% of natural gas, and 33% of oil, must simply stay in the ground. Does your party agree that Canada must keep some of its reserves buried? That would be the maybe. Yes, no, maybe. All right, well, there's a fourth category. Robert-Falcon Ouellette, you put up what, no? Yes, maybe, okay. Explain why maybe.
Well, at the end of the day, we use plastics in everything that we do around the world, and whether we like it or not, you look around you here today, my keychain has plastic on it, the seats you're sitting are made of plastic, and that comes from oil. And unfortunately, unless we're going to go back to an age of 150 years ago, it's going to be very hard to get away from using oil in everything we do. And the tar sands, unfortunately, just the way that we've set up our economies around the world, there will always be a demand for it. The question is how we're going to be using it, whether we're going to be burning it, or whether we're going to be using it for other transformative purposes.
Matt Henderson.
Yeah, I think it's a really complex issue, and a yes-no question is a little bit difficult. We want to be able to make that transition from fossil fuel dependency to green technologies and green energy. When it comes down to, I don't think it's just tar sands in the question, I think it was natural gas and coal and all that kind of stuff. We heat our houses with natural gas, and so how do we make that transition into green technologies and green economies and societies? And I think we have to start with by cutting emissions. I mean, that's the big thing that we have to do, but also by ensuring that we are providing companies and researchers with support in order to develop these technologies. And I think also what we have to do is we have to unmuzzle our scientists and allow them to do their work, and then bring back rigorous assessments, so that anytime we do take something out of the ground, that we have experts telling us whether that's sustainable or not.
And Mark.
Okay. It may be politically complex, but it's scientifically fairly simple. We know with certainty that if we do not leave some of these reserves in the ground, we will fail to meet our climate targets. And in fact, the pledges that have been made in advance of the COP21 talks in Paris have already been described as inadequate to keep warming under 2 degrees. The pledges in carbon reduction, as they are currently laid out, will see warming of 2.7 or even over 3 degrees. Okay? So it is a fact that a lot of these fuel reserves have to stay in the ground. Mark Jacquard, one of our leading energy economists, has described the effects of Tory procrastination over the last decade, and has come out unequivocally and said we will not be able to meet even our very modest 17% target by the year 2020 because of previous procrastination, right? The International Energy Agency has said that some reserves have to stay in the ground, the World Bank has said it, and a majority of climate scientists are saying it.
So, in the interest of time, because we do want to get to open mic, what I'm going to do here is we'll keep on with the placards, but we'll just have one of you speaking after that. We'll continue going on the proper order, so that'll be fine. So, question number three, is your party committed to implementing a renewed home energy retrofit program with professional energy audits? Matt Henderson, you get to talk to this one. Go.
Yeah, no, I mean, part of that transition from fossil fuels is to ensure that we are providing industry, but also people the ability to retrofit their homes and to ensure that they are energy efficient, because that comes back into GDP and it helps lower income folks as well, and it's a no-brainer.
All right, number four. Let's see, this is a lot faster. Provinces that have already put a price on carbon have seen economic growth that outpaces the Canadian average. Is your party committed to implementing a national carbon pricing policy? Mr. Park, you get to speak to this one.
Yeah, well, I've already described the Green Party's fee and dividend. The beauty of the fee and dividend is, A, it's progressive, right? Low-income Canadians will benefit from an equal check distributed to all Canadians. Low-income Canadians use a lot less carbon than rich Canadians. By some estimates, the bottom 10th percentile used about one-fifth of the gasoline of the top 10th percentile. So it's redistribution, in a manner of speaking. You also benefit from a predictable price on carbon, which started approximately $30 a ton, which is where the BC carbon tax and dividend is now. And that predictable price provides a very important signal to the market, which will lead to growth in energy innovation and adoption. Okay, alternative energy innovation and adoption. Okay, I'll leave it at that.
Number five, Canadians subsidize the fossil fuel industry to the tune of over $1.3 billion a year with additional subsidies from producing provinces. Is your party committed to ending these subsidies and promoting a diversified, more stable economy? Robert-Falcon, Ouellette, you can speak to this.
Well, we're going to fulfill the G20 commitment that was made by Canada to phase out fossil fuel subsidies. So it's just clear and simple as that.
Number six, with the fall of oil prices and rapid growth in renewable technology, Is your party committed to encouraging a transition to a low-carbon, clean tech economy? Matt Henderson, you can speak to that one.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's the transition that we keep talking about. It means about providing certainly that $55 million to granting organizations, to unmuzzling scientists, to providing grants, innovation grants to small business. It means to allowing small business, because we know that's where a lot of the innovation happens, to do their work. We're going to drop the small business tax from 11 to 9% to help stimulate that push to that research and that R&D and that transition. And
Number seven, and bear with me here because it's a fascinating question and there's an A and a B here to this. Hormones and hormone mimickers that enter wastewater act as endocrine disruptors and can cause fish to develop sexual abnormalities. I think we see this in Manitoba in one creek in the Morden-Winkler area. Traditional sewage treatment does not remove these hormones. However, it has been shown that full biological nutrient removal reduces the presence of these hormones between 75 and 90%. Full biological nutrient removal removes ammonia and nitrogen as well as phosphorus by passing the wastewater through zones containing different kinds of bacteria. Part A here is, if your party forms the next government, would you require new wastewater treatment plants that discharge into waters that cross provincial or national boundaries to employ full biological nutrient removal? You may quickly reply to yourself now. Andrew Park, you get to speak to this one.
I was hoping you'd pass over that one, but this is where I got a little fudgy.
This is the issue that Winnipeg is facing.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, look, if you were to talk to Dr. David Schindler, who knows like infinitely more about this stuff than me, he would say that the important thing for reducing eutrophication is to remove the phosphorus, and that a lot of money can be wasted removing the nitrogen. But now the endocrine disruptors are adding a new kind of element to that equation. And I got to say, as a scientist, I feel rather unqualified to talk about that. We know that it is. I haven't heard about the creek in Gordon and what they're doing down there.
Fellow UW researcher.
Is that right?
Yeah.
The St. Lawrence River is known to have this problem, right? Feminized fish and all the rest of that. And I think what we need to, if I were approaching this as a PhD thesis or something, I'd say, okay, let's first review this problem. How widespread is it? How difficult is it, and how much is it going to cost to fix?
Okay, the part B of this is a lot easier. Would you also make funds available to assist municipalities in upgrading their systems? Robert-Falcon will let you get to speak to this one.
Yeah, so I talked about this in the mayoral campaign, various things that municipalities we can be doing in order to raise funds, such as having more of a greater depot on your bottles and pop cans and beverage containers, but we are committed to spending $20 billion on green infrastructure across the country, and it's up to municipalities and the provinces to decide with the federal government how that money will be spent in your priorities. So this is where the role of the public comes in advocating for some of these solutions to their federal government as well as provincial and municipal governments about what you'd like to see.
And it's billions of dollars. It is billions of dollars.
$20 billion.
Yeah. But no, to solve these problems. Over 100 countries, this is question A, recognize the right to a healthy environment in their constitution. Part A, does your party currently support making a clean environment a human right? Okay. B, if not, would you consider raising the possibility in caucus so that does not occur there at all? So, Matt Henderson, you get to speak to this, both A and B, because you all agree, yes.
Sure. No, this is fundamental to the NDP and near to my heart. As this is what we talk about, I teach the law course and then the global issues course at SJR, and we talk about human rights at length, and we talk about the Charter of Rights and Freedoms at length. And certainly, we're going to be talking with Dave Suzuki on Thursday night about it, as we're calling a bunch of kids out and he's really brought up the idea that this is fundamentally to be able to live in an environment, and the thing that the biosphere that sustains life is a human right, and it's something that we fully support.
Two more questions, then we get to open mics. So stand by for that while mics on both sides here. Question 9. Exposure to wireless devices is a daily struggle for individuals with electromagnetic hypersensitivity, EHS, which leads to symptoms ranging from headaches to heart irregularities. EHS is recognized and treated as a functional impairment in other countries. If elected, would your party provide funding for research into EHS testing, diagnosis, and treatment? Good question.
Okay. Well, I've had a chance to read through the recommendations of the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Health on this issue, and there are a number of recommendations, for instance, for the exposure of children to wireless radiation and the like. And these recommendations are fairly non-controversial, and I'm happy to adopt them. The World Health Organization has quite a bit of literature on this, and the World Health Organization describes a condition that is a constellation of symptoms, but it is very, very difficult to pin down exactly whether these symptoms can be directly attributed to wireless radiation or not. This doesn't mean that the symptoms are any less real, right? People definitely experience these symptoms. The question is whether, in fact, we can pin it down to a particular exposure to wireless radiation. And so I would definitely support more research into it and definitely support testing. But whether it justifies treatment, that is pending the results of that research.
Thank you very much. Article 29 of the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People says, quote, "Indigenous peoples have the right to their environment being protected, and conservation and protection of the environment, lands, and resources. Governments will respect and protect the right of Indigenous peoples to develop and protect their lands, water bodies, and other natural resources. If elected, will you fully implement the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People and work in partnership with Indigenous peoples to uphold this declaration?" Robert-Falcon, Ouellette, you get a minute.
Yeah, I'm very proud about this measure. We had a long conversation between me and the Brain Trust of the Liberal Party, Mr. Trudeau, and some of his advisors about this important issue, and I was very pleased early on in the campaign when he announced that we were going to be implementing the Universal Declaration on Human Rights for Indigenous Peoples. And I think this is a fantastic thing for our country, because we were the only country that wasn't doing so around the world. We, in fact, put some caveats against the implementation of this, the interpretation, and we'll be removing those, because we believe it is to the benefit of Canada if we can build a trust relationship, a proper relationship with our First Nations peoples and Indigenous peoples of this land, so we can all live together, hopefully, for the benefit of each and every one of us.
Thank you. All right, open mic time. We've got just over half an hour to do this, so.
Can I be bold, and if you guys don't mind, I have to run out very, very quickly to take care of some business. Biological business, would that be permitted if I did that?
That's not a problem. That's not a problem.
I've been 60 seconds, ring the bell when I'm done.
Yes, not a problem.
As long as you don't put any nitrogen in there.
We have a question here, and I can certainly paraphrase for when Matt comes back. So go ahead, you can address your question to any one of the three candidates, but I would encourage you to pick either Robert or Andrew. All right, folks, we want to have attention over here.
Am I on?
Please and thank you. You are. Go ahead. Okay. And again, 1 minute total for a little preamble and then your question, because this is not about you, this is about these folks. Okay?
I can be succinct when I want to. My question is for Robert. The government of Fred Martin signed the Cloutuer Protocol, and if my memory serves me well, it's 95, and somebody, I'm sure there are people who are better informed who might correct me. Between that and the coming to power of the Harper Conservancy, I think all agree about their level of commitment, how much did our greenhouse gases diminish?
that's a hard question for me to answer because I was in high school at that time when that commitment was made. But nonetheless, I'll tell you what we're committed to doing today. We're committed to actually going to Paris in December of 2015 and having these negotiations like I've already said before. And I realize perhaps people look back and say, oh, nothing was done. But nothing was done around the world. And you can look to the United States and not very much has been done. You remember there was a different government in power at that time. I'm very supportive of Mr. Obama with his new measures, and I think we have a partner that we can work with in the United States today. But it seemed that we didn't have the type of partnerships that we could use in order to push this issue forward. There were still a lot of people who didn't believe in climate change. There was a lot of climate change deniers. And so hopefully today there is that public will to push our politicians forward on this file. And I know I'll be pushing forward on this file.
So the question really is, and Matt and Andrew, you can address it, is, you know, the record suggests something otherwise when it comes to being able to fulfill our obligations to the Kyoto Protocol. Why should we trust Robert-Falcon, Ouellette, and the Liberals? That's really the essence, I think, of your question. So Matt and Andrew, go ahead.
Sure. Well, I can only speak for the NDP, and what we're going to do is put real caps on emissions, and that's what we need across the country. We can't wait, and we need to be able to. And we have set rigorous targets that we want to bring into COP21. That to be able to say these are the targets that Canada has committed to, and these are the targets that we're going to hit. And I think that's critical at this time because. The last few times that Canada has shown up at these conferences, it hasn't gone well for us, and I think we need to show our global leadership in this sense.
Andrew?
Well, I'm a numbers and evidence sort of guy, so I'm going to give you some numbers and evidence. Europe committed to 80% below 1990 levels by 2050, and Stephen Harper miraculously signed on to that pledge. I don't think he quite connected the fact that he'd have to actually honour that pledge going forward. So where are we at? In 1990, we emitted 699 million tonnes of carbon. So 80% below that level is 139.8 million tonnes. So that gives you the magnitude of the task we have before us. But emissions are going up. In spite of what the Tories say, emissions have gone up 4% in the last 4 years. And we're now at 18% above 1990 levels. Sorry about that.
Over here, please.
Does the question have to be in line with the environment, or is it a question?
We're really trying to skew this towards the environment, but it is an open mic, so, you know, hey, it's an open mic.
All of that. My question is starting off with the whole issue of unemployment and the whole issue of the environment and how those things can be addressed. I'm hoping at some point that we could take a look at the idea of remediation of products that are being manufactured. When we buy tires, there's a fee that's attached to those tires that are supposed to go towards cleaning up any damage those tires can create. If we put this on electronics, we put this on a whole bunch of other products, we can actually create two streams of employment, one for manufacturing the item and one for cleaning up the messes that we created. My question is, are any of these parties willing to adopt this as a platform to create full employment, to have balanced budgets, to have budgets that have money left over for infrastructure and everything else?
Who wants to go first on that?
Sure. No, it's a great question, and I think that we know that as we move forward and move to new technologies, that we're going to have more employment, and the data has shown us that. I think what it's needed in particular when we look at Manitoba is often we don't have the infrastructure to actually deal with a lot of the products that we're using and are supposed to be either recycling or re-engineering, and I think that's something that needs to be addressed. Out of ignorance, I'll say I'm not sure if that's within that's specifically stated in the NDP's platform, but that's certainly something that I would raise at caucus.
Anybody else want to comment?
Sure.
Andrew?
I really like your idea. I cannot say that I'd actually thought about it before, but this is the exact sort of thing that we need to adopt going forward. The specific type of pricing on, you know, recycling the electronics, etc., is not exactly in the Green Party platform at the moment, but we welcome ideas, good ideas, from wherever they come. At the moment, of course, we recycle a lot of our electronics in developing countries and China. Okay, so it would be a very good idea, but you know, to recycle some of that stuff here. But in order to do that, we would have to revitalize the Canadian manufacturing sector, which is something I'm solidly behind.
Robert, do you want to take a second?
Well, I talked about this in the mayoral campaign with bottles and trying to fund a water treatment plant in the north end of the city of Winnipeg. I don't know if this is actually a federal jurisdiction. I couldn't tell you off the top of my head, whether I believe it's actually a provincial jurisdiction related to that. So I'm going to assume it is, because bottles are actually regulated like that, as well as tires. And so what we can do is we can work with the provinces, but in this case, you know, we're trying to have a comprehensive global approach to all these issues, but we are committed to employment and trying to build more employment in the technology fields related to green technology. And so over the last decade, we've lost actually 71% of the market share of Canada in green technology compared to other countries in the industrialized world. And we're committed to spending $20 billion to try and get part of our market share back, because we think a lot of the new jobs in the future are going to be related to green infrastructure. And for a lot of young people, they need to be good paying jobs, not just simply $15 an hour, but $25, $30, $40.
Over here.
Thank you.
I'm Eric with the Wilderness Committee. I'm a professional agitator, I guess. Oh, I've got a question about species at risk. We partnered with the West Coast Department of Law last week to do a forum on environmental laws, and the data that's being released by West Coast Department of Law tomorrow is on my phone in front of me. So this question is in at Matt, because I don't have an answer from the NDP on this, but the Species at Risk Act was implemented in 2003, and there's about 800 species on it, and there's only recovery strategies for about 180 of them. And so the commitment that we need is enough money so that we can roll out recovery and action plans for species at risk. And the cuts that were made in C-38 in 2012 to the Species at Risk Act stated that pipelines no longer had to adhere to the Species at Risk Act. So the position, I guess, of parties in the NDP would be great.
Eric, can you use a couple of examples of what species we're talking about that are at risk?
Well, the woodland caribou was one of the biggest ones that we worked on across the country. They're present in Manitoba, but we brought the federal government to court 8 times and won every single one of them so far. Killer whales, sage ducks, Nipsock dace. So in Manitoba, it's woodland caribou. We're going across the prairies and say Energy East is going to run into whale habitat in St. Lawrence Seaway. So species everywhere is affected by pipelines, but the laws can change so that we no longer have to pay attention to them.
Good. Yeah. Keep agitating.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Eric. It speaks to the 9 planetary boundaries, right, that we talk about, or I talk about with my students at Rockstrom et al. have addressed, where there are 9 planetary boundaries for which we exist, and we've already surpassed 4 of them, and species diversification is certainly one of them, and it's a great concern of mine. And I think what you're speaking about specifically to C-38 and the fact that species are at risk, and you know, whether it's pipelines or whether it's other sort of resource exploitation, that's where we need that rigorous environmental assessment to come in. In terms of the Species at Risk Act, I'm not entirely sure what the NDP's position is on it, but I can certainly find out. I have a fast track to them, obviously, and we can talk tomorrow if you want. That'd be great.
Thank you. Anybody else want to comment on that?
Sure.
Just take a few seconds.
From my point of view as a biologist, I'm not specific speaking to Green Party policy here. I believe we need to break open the entire Species at Risk Act. The Act as it stands allows governments to basically allow extirpation through neglect. And we've seen this example with the northern spotted owl in British Columbia, where neither the feds nor the province was willing to protect critical spotted owl habitat from logging. Another example closer to home is the sage grass, which was recently threatened by oil and gas development, and an emergency order had to be issued in order to prevent that economic development from endangering sage grass breeding habitat. So there's a couple of examples.
Robert?
And we're just committed to in protecting and ensuring that the Species and Risk Act will be reinforced, and that that it continues to be involved in the assessment process in any major projects that go across Canada, and that it's not no political interference in that process.
Thanks. I'm really impressed with the thoughtful and cooperative debate. I hope that's reflective of what we see after October 20th as well. The first question we had today was about science and cuts to science, as well as the public science that's being lost over the last several years. There's another leg of public science that we have, and that's the knowledge and expertise that's contained within the public, citizen science. And we've had a real loss of consultations over the last 4 years, and in particular, we have several hundred environmental groups across Canada who have an immense repository of knowledge. Cuts to groups like the RCN, as well as networks across Canada, including the Manitoba Eco Network, had the funding cut. What will you do to restore that expertise and restore funding to those methods of consultation?
Robert, you can start.
So once again, we're just committed to ensuring that public funding of science can occur in not only public institutions like universities, but also with parapublic or NGOs. And I suspect, at the end of the day, I have heard that we're not committed to using too much of consultants anymore in the administration or assessment of a lot of projects. We're more committed to actually using public employees in many of the things that we'd like to be doing. I don't know if you've heard about that, in order to try and save 1%, because we do use an awful lot of consultants. But at the end of the day, I guess it's about a philosophy and a change of philosophy that you need to have. And so this is what we're proposing. It's a mentality change around how we conceive of government.
Yeah, and I know that a lot of organizations, not just environmental organizations and research organizations, have been threatened not only with loss of funding, but in terms of charitable status and that route, right? And I find that pretty despicable in terms of how we've threatened, or there have been conservative members of parliament calling environmentalists sort of eco-terrorists and stuff like that. And I think that's an issue, and as Robert spoke about, a change in philosophy and a change in a relationship. And just correct me if I'm wrong, I'm assuming that Manitoba Eco Network, if folks are here, you're getting some federal and provincial funding as well, is that the case? Yeah, okay. And I think that comes down to the federal government working with the provinces and saying, do we value the work that these organizations do? And if so, how can we make sure that the provinces are funded enough and that the federal government is providing that funding for those organizations? And I'm sure that's something the NDP would be committed to doing.
Yeah. Okay. So as a Canadian scientist, I'm all for anything that will enable me to do a lot of work cheaply. And by golly, if I can get people to work for free, I'll do it. So there's a huge untapped potential for citizen science in Canada. We do have some citizen science initiatives, Plant Watch, Ice Watch, Frog Watch, and the like, and I think they're an excellent idea, because if you can train those citizen scientists to take accurate data, you can leverage your expertise to a great degree. And I'm afraid this is one area where the Americans have got us beat, and the Europeans as well. When you look at, say, the European Phenology Network, vast network of observers observing the flowering times and the bud sets of over 1,000 different species of plants, right? This is the sort of thing that we should be aspiring to, right? And I think we can do it, and I think we could do it at a relatively small cost.
So we have 20 minutes left. I'll commit to everybody that's standing, you'll get your questions in. I would suggest maybe you want to give somebody the opportunity first. Just go to the back of the line, I'll likely get to you, but let's just do it that way. So hopefully a couple more have gotten up, hopefully we can get to everybody over here, please.
Hi, my name's Dave. I've been an environmental activist for 25 years. Back in the 1990s when we had environmental laws, I found them, they were fairly weak, but at least we had them. Now, I'm very concerned about the pipeline, the energy pipeline in particular. And I'm probably not alone in this audience in saying that as long as I draw breath, that pipeline won't be going to its promise. As far as the federal government's role in regulation, I wish I could talk to the conservative candidate because the NEB process is a nightmare. It doesn't do anything. I didn't take part in the NEB process because I didn't think it was a legitimate authority on the matter. Now we have an opportunity, perhaps, to rebuild some of these environmental laws, and what I would like to see is a strong federal presence, a strong federal government in terms of regulation that can counteract the wishes of the province. Like, we have Premier Brad Wall saying that he's, you know, wants to get this pipeline through. We have our own Premier Selinger saying that he's going to, you know, reduce the red tape. The question, how would you strengthen the federal government's role with the environmental regulation in your capacity?
Let's start this end with Andrew.
Okay, so I'm going to veer off of official Green Party policy slightly and go into my personal view on this. In my humble opinion, the National Energy Board is not the appropriate body to make decisions on whether or not a pipeline should proceed. The National Energy Board originally was an energy regulator. It was a pipeline safety regulator. It is largely composed of former oil people and geophysicists and the like. And this is a huge problem. If we cast our minds back, those of us that can remember the Mackenzie Valley pipeline inquiry, that was chaired by Justice Thomas Berger. And they spent, I can't remember how many years they spent, but they had probably the most fullest and complete inquiry into an industrial development in the history of this country. And I'm afraid, you know, if we want to conserve our environment for future generations, we've got to go back to some of that. And at the very least, if we're going to have hearings into these pipelines and call them legitimate, we've got to not just have oil people on the panels. We've got to bring in sociologists, we've got to bring in ecologists, we've got to bring in anthropologists who are going to adequately assess the input of the interveners.
Robert?
So part of our platform related to the National Energy Board and these pipelines is to ensure that there's actually regional representation, but also sufficient expertise in various fields such as environmental science, community development, and traditional indigenous knowledge on the National Energy Board. And so the idea is to have a wider base of people who can give more input about whether projects should go forward or not, and ensuring that they also meet indigenous people's requirements and desires. Matt?
Yeah, and first of all, we want to make sure that we have legislation. And to be honest, I'm not sure what the constitutional requirement is or the relationship between the provinces and feds in terms of pipeline regulation. But I think what we need to start with is federal legislation that's strong, and then to be able to have a prime minister who will actually sit down with the provinces and talk about whether or not that the experts, so not only communities, not only First Nations, not only scientists have said this is an appropriate project, whatever that might be. But then also to talk about seriously about having a national energy strategy. How is it that we provide energy, whether it's hydroelectric energy, whether it's wind, whether it's whatever, how do we ensure that we're making that transition, that we're providing all communities with energy, and whether it's in the south or whether it's in the north, so everybody has access to that. I think that's a big part that the federal government can play.
I think it's fair to say that's shared jurisdiction, right? On the hearing side, and often what has happened is that federal government and province or provinces have decided to share the hearing process and have one streamlined body do the hearings.
On pipelines, it's a completely federal process.
It is?
So
okay.
Whatsoever.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Over
here, please. My name is Margaret Reese, and I'm a former federal biologist and retired now. And I certainly agree with the comments that were made about scientists public service. There is one exception, and that is the scientists in charge of the wireless radiation issue for Health Canada. There's been a profound failure by that particular department in adequately warning people about the dangers of wireless radiation. In 2011, the World Health Organization classify wireless radiation. We're talking about cell phones and wireless radiation that our children are being exposed to in schools as a possible carcinogen. And the main scientist that they depend on for information is now considering it, calling for a known carcinogen. The scientist that was interviewed in 2010 when Wi-Fi was widely deployed in schools said there was no evidence. There is. We need more proper education on that particular topic, as well as review the scientific literature. I'd like to know what the candidate's thoughts are on that.
Who wants to go on that? I think you kind of dealt with that earlier, but you can go all three if you want to go. Andrew?
Sure. I'll quickly address that. And Margaret, thanks for the question. And I think this is one of those questions where your local MP can really step up. And you know, if I end up being elected on the 19th of October, I'll give you a solemn promise that I will review all the literature around wireless radiation. My knowledge is incomplete. I've looked at the World Health Organization and the Standing Committee on Health, as we discussed in earlier conversations, and you heard my thoughts at the moment. But I would very much like, as I say, if I were elected, I would very much like the opportunity to review that literature.
Matt?
Yeah, the NDP is committed to supporting research in the area and allowing Health Canada to do that research.
Robert?
I think the problem right now is trying to put the genie back in the bottle with all the Wi-Fi around here and everything that's going on in our society. It's ubiquitous, it's everywhere. You can't get away from it. Shaw, MTS. And you know, Dr. Hedy Fry, I think on March 5th on 2015, she put forward a motion that she would like a House of Commons Health Committee to actually study this in greater detail, to actually understand this issue and what measures the Canadian government could possibly take. But that is, you know, obviously a first step is studying the issue and understanding scientific and, you know, based public policy on science.
We have 10 minutes left, so I want to try to get everybody in. Go ahead.
Tim Byers, I work with Aboriginal people in the NDP, and I'd like to know your party's position on the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And I understand that shareholders' rights is a clause in just about every international agreement, including NAFTA. I know there's a, for example, an indigenous community in Chiapas, Mexico, which are dealing with Blackfire, a Canadian exploration company, mining company. Long story short, the company has threatened the state of Chiapas, one of the poorest states in Mexico, with suing them for what they think they will make in profit if they are not allowed to mine, which is $800 million. So, long story short, would your parties have a serious re-look at our participation in the Trans-Pacific, which, as far as I understand, has been fairly secretive behind closed door negotiation?
And to be fair, we haven't seen the text of the 1,500 pages of this yet. They promised to release it, but not yet. Part.
So the position of the Liberal Party, as well as myself, is we haven't seen the text, so we don't know what's actually contained within it. All we know is what the government is releasing at this moment and what they say has happened. And so we're committed to having after the election, obviously, because we're not going to know apparently until October 19th when some of these texts might be released. But afterwards, we're committed to having a full and open debate in the House of Commons and consulting with Canadians to ensure that this is what Canada would like to do, and this is what Canadians is in the long-term benefit and in their interest for maintaining jobs, but also protections of Canadian sovereignty.
Matt?
Yeah, I think Tom has been pretty clear with the TPP. If it threatens Canadians, if it threatens the Canadian economy, if it threatens the Canadian environment, if it threatens Canadian services like the CBC or Canada Post or anything like that, we will not ratify it.
And
I'm profoundly worried about trade agreements that contain investor state protection. I'm very, very worried about that. We should never have signed FIPA. We should have been very, very conservative about whether or not to sign the agreement with the European Community. And I do not believe that any trade agreement is negotiated in secret should be ratified, because we're the people who are going to have to live with the consequences of that trade agreement, and we deserve to know the details. So, you know, It has been negotiated largely in secret, so it's tough to comment on all of it, but there have been leaks from WikiLeaks. At one point, I believe there was a clause in this agreement that would have looked at the privatization of public broadcasters, right? How do you like them apples? And so I can only speculate as to the other horrors that are hidden underneath the white folders or whatever they use to hold their papers.
And that wasn't the CJOB clause, by the way. We're going to go right over here, again here.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank everybody for the conversation we've had around water this evening, and I'm afraid I have one more. In Manitoba, we lose on average 15 acres of wetlands every day in southwestern Manitoba alone. Given that fewer wetlands means increased risk of flooding, vulnerability to drought, more nutrients to our lakes, increased release of greenhouse gases, as well as the loss of habitat in more than 600 species of plants and animals, many of which are species at risk. If you are elected, given that loss of wetlands means negatively impacts our environment, our economy, and our way of life, how will you ensure the wetlands, the protection of the wetlands require before 2020 as of taking a date out of the year?
We'll start with now.
Sure, and the wetlands, but specifically in the interlake and around the interlake, are part of my existence, part of my childhood, and it's something that I have introduced my kids to, and the importance of those, and they understand. They're starting to think in systems, right? To be able to say that we're connected to every single system, and that those systems create a rich ecology, and one of the things that we've been able to do at the school level is introduce students to the notion to expert scientists, right, who are already not only reintroducing wetland areas, but looking at ways of controlling phosphorus, right, through cattails and using that for biofuel and other, or using that for agricultural purposes. And I think that's the push. That's what we need to be able to do, is not only preserve the wetland use, but to come up with innovative ways of dealing with the nutrients going through and that are escaping the wetlands and that are going into our lakes.
So moratorium or no net loss?
To be perfectly frank, I can speak for myself, but I'm speaking for the party here. I'm not sure what their position is, but I can certainly get back to you on that. I don't want to overstep myself.
And it would be no net loss of wetlands or no net loss of wetland benefits? Sorry, just throw that in.
I'll have to get back to you on that. Okay.
Robert?
Yeah, so I've said time and time again in this campaign that I'm focused on Winnipeg Center, and you know, I'd love to talk about the wetlands outside of the city, but you know, I know there is a wetlands, it's called the Parker Wetlands, inside our city, and I'm very concerned about that because it is symbolic, it is connection for people within the city to something which is here in the environment and nature, and does play an important role. And I'm not in favor, obviously, you can perhaps tell, but where my position lies, and and at the end of the day, what I'm going to advocate for is something completely different. And so, other than that, I don't know my party's position on wetlands.
Yeah. Okay, so I think we have to think about not just no net loss, but I think we have to look at selective restoration of wetlands. And I wish my colleague Scott Forbes was here, because I've had a lot of good conversations with Scott about this, particularly around the small internal drainages, right, many of which have been drained and the contours of the land reframed so that drainage, instead of running internally into these small drainages, ends up flowing into dikes, creeks, rivers. And in his opinion, it's very possible that the loss of a lot of these small internal drainages could have made the 2011 flood quite a bit worse than it would otherwise have been. And so I think as a, you know, as a climate adaptation strategy, I think we have to closely examine these internal drainages. We also have to closely examine opportunities to bring back wetlands that were not there before. I also think it's not going to be altogether easy, because a lot of this stuff is on private land, and appropriate compensation mechanisms are going to have to be set up if we're going to do stuff like that. But I think we've got to look at our wetlands holistically as an overall land management ingredient.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. I've got five more minutes left here, so I think we have two more questions here. Let's begin over here.
Hi, my name is Kim Park, and I will disclose full disclosure, I'm running for the candidate Nella Transcona. The environment is very important to me, and what I'm hearing from the candidates, they're concerned about, or the other my constituents, they're concerned about it too. A couple of things. There was a survey that said that 93% of the Canadians are concerned about climate change. My question is, I know that two of the candidates on the panel parties have disclosed that they are for the legalization taxation of marijuana. Now, wouldn't that be the perfect marriage to have that money, all those resources go into developing the good quality jobs that we do need? Since during the Harper regime, we have the lowest job creation of any prime minister in Canada. And I'd also like to speak to the question about, or the concern about.
So what's the question? I just have time.
My
for
question,
question
is, wouldn't that be the perfect marriage to use the billions of dollars that's going to be coming from the legalization, regulation, and taxation of marijuana to develop this new green technology that we've known about for many, many, many decades, and nothing's been done about it, and no one's moved on it, and oil is only 2% of the gross national
product. All right, let's begin with Matt on that.
Sure.
My debate.
Okay, my party's position is that we're decriminalizing it, not legalizing it, but our position in order so that we can move forward. One of the things that we'll do is raise the corporate tax rate from 15 to 17% so that corporations actually pay their fair share.
So there's more waste of money in the courts.
Andrew.
Yeah, we would legalize it and tax it, and it's part of the Green Party budget that we envisage over the lifetime of Parliament. I believe the revenues anticipated from taxation are approximately $2 billion.
Yeah. Way higher than
that. Robert. We're going to be regulating the use of marijuana to keep it out of the hands of children and as well as criminal gangs. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Right
and
over
also,
here.
I would
I'm
just
sorry.
Like to
right
comment.
Over here. Thank you very much. Right over here.
Canadians are the largest consumers of energy per capita worldwide. And part of that dismal record on energy savings or consumption is. That the cars that drive Canadian roads have a dismal fuel economy. Unfortunately, consumers and manufacturers seem to only react when the fuel prices go up, and they make promises that they will reduce fuel economy and that will use their car less. Would, if elected, maybe I directed at Robert, would your party increase fuel tax substantially and not use that money into general revenue, but specifically use it to fund our decaying public transport system?
Andrew first, then we'll go
Robert. It was directed to Robert. So
okay, go ahead, Robert.
But if time...
Yeah, we got time for all three.
Sure. I'm not going to commit to that because I don't know exactly what the budget is related to something like that. And but I will say simply that you know, with looking at the Volkswagen issue, that I think the regulator should have a much greater role to play in ensuring that car manufacturers are actually meeting the requirements that we have set for them with emission standards right across the country. And if they do fail to do so, that you know they should pay the you know some consequences for that. I don't know what doesn't answer your question completely, but. Not much time.
Andrew, then Matt, then we'll have time for the last question.
Okay. So yeah, we're not quite the most profligate users of greenhouse gas emissions per capita. We rank about seventh, but that still leaves about 200 countries behind us. However, I'm not exactly sure how we would regulate stuff with gas tax. We've been working on an America-wide basis to look at CAFE standards, right, the fuel consumption standards. And I think California has the highest CAFE standards in North America. And it always amazes me why our CAFE standards are so low. When I was in the UK last time, the rental car rental agency upgraded me to a diesel BMW, which was, yes, very nice, thank you. And, you know, if we can believe the fuel consumption statistics, I was getting approximately 60 miles per gallon out of that thing. So we know we can do it. I'm just not sure why we're not doing it here.
Okay, Matt?
Yeah, just really quickly, one of the examples that I use all the time in terms, I mean, first of all, the NDP is pushing to put the gas tax to municipalities so that it can actually have that predictable funding for transit and public transit and infrastructure in that regard. And I look at the Danes as sort of a shining example of people who consume very little energy, and yet for some reason are the happiest people on earth, right? They're always winding up, I don't know what it is, maybe it's Lego or something, but they pay, in terms for their energy, they pay considerable, they pay five times for electricity, they're taxed 100% on cars, and yet they're still happy because they've been able to create sustainable communities based on community, but based on transit, and based on the ability that that they don't need to have as much, to consume as much. And I think that might be an area that I certainly see in education, is changing attitudes and beliefs and behaviors as we move forward. Because we as Canadians, we seem to consume a vast amount of energy, whether it's in vehicles or other vehicles. Part of that is where we live and our geography. But I think part of it is cultural, right? We just consume a lot of energy.
We have wrap-ups coming up, but very brief question, very brief answers.
Okay, this is a very quick. My name is Glenn Zarezky, and for disclosure, I'm also a candidate, Green Party in St. Lawrence, St. Michel. I haven't got a question, though. I've got a comment. I've been on panels like this throughout Rama.
If it's not a question,
I have to offer kudos to all the people I see up here, the three parties that have been involved in this. And it's disturbing to me, maybe you don't go to all these things, every single one I've been to, save one with radio, the Conservatives haven't been there. I find that really disturbing. I'm green to this, you might say, and I offer a big round of applause to Liberals.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much. All right, to wrap things up, and we did the draw beforehand, the first to wrap up here, and I believe it's 3 minutes. Yes, 3 minutes?
4 minutes.
4 minutes.
Wow. We'll maybe try to get 3.5 because we are behind time.
Okay.
Robert-Falcon, Ouellette, 3 minutes and 25 seconds. Go.
Well, thank you very much for having me here tonight to speak to each and every one of you and to offer some of my thoughts on this very important topic. But I hope when you consider about the ballot issue of what you're going to be voting for on October 19th, you'll also consider other issues which are just as equally important in our city and our country. And one of the reasons that I'm running is I live in Manitoba, near the University of Manitoba, and I see the great divide in our city. I see what is happening in our city. And Winnipeg Centre, for instance, is one of the poorest ridings in our country. But we can make a difference. We can bridge that divide, which I don't believe is always a racial divide, but a socio-economic divide. But we can use it, we can bridge that divide through some of our public policy. And this is part of the fun thing, is you can combine various elements. You can take a holistic view about what we do in public policy. So we can address the poverty issue in Winnipeg Centre with the child tax benefit that we're proposing, which is about $6,000 a year, which is going to lift 315,000 children out of poverty. But we can also bridge that divide through having an efficient public transportation system in our city, which is also environmentally sound. We can set ourselves up for a long-term future, a city which is growing, and will be able to reach eventually 1 million people. And this is the beauty of being hopefully in government, or perhaps in opposition. We can be hopefully optimistic for the future. But the ability to influence the course of events. But this we cannot do by ourselves, because the ideas do not simply come from the candidates who are up here, but they come from individuals like yourselves and the influence that you have not only on our level of government, but on provincial and municipal government, on school boards, in pushing your public officials to take other decisions and other courses of action that will have a major impact and allow me to do my job in a better way. And so when you go to the ballot box, remember it's not about, your work does not end on October 19th, it simply begins as my work begins as well. And so I hope you will take the moment to consider about the policies that we propose, $20 billion in green infrastructure, $20 billion in public transit, $20 billion in social infrastructure, which you can combine and ensure that we have a social housing and affordable housing which is environmentally sound, public transportation which is environmentally sound, and also ensuring that people do not live in a state of poverty and privilege as many of us do. So please, thank you very much, and please vote on October 19th. Tapuiki tuwa.
Next up is Matt Henderson.
Yeah, thank you very much, everybody. This has been really great, and you've had fantastic questions, and it'll be great to have discussion afterwards. I have report cards due tomorrow morning, so I won't stick around too long, but and I haven't even started.
They all get it.
They all did well. But it's been great to be on the panel with Robert and Andrew. I think this is our fifth or sixth time on a panel together, and it's been just a privilege to be able to run with you and run against you, and or however we want to do that. It's a tremendous amount of integrity, and it's been great to have a discussion, and I think we're already in cahoots and some plans for education in the future. But for me, this discussion hasn't been on the forefront of people's minds in this election. There's been a few things that have escaped the Canadian discussion, and we've been blinded by issues with the niqab and issues that really aren't that essential to meeting the basic needs of Canadians. And climate change is a real threat, not only to our way of life, but to those people who are particularly our most vulnerable. And I don't want to be crazy partisan here, but the NDP has pledged to ensure that we are capping emissions, and we have a fundamental plan to go into COP21 and to address emissions and to provide that leadership. And that's something that I can hang my hat on, because this is going to be, as I said, the test of our civilization coming up. And for me, when I look at kids in the eyes every day, I have to ensure that I'm doing my utmost to ensure that their future and their children's future is sustained. And that comes down to a variety of things. I mean, we're talking about poverty and well-being. As I walk through the riding, Winnipeg South Centre, I think people think that in contrast to Winnipeg Centre, is a very affluent riding, and I think it is, but I've walked through many, many pockets where people are struggling. And that this is not on the tip of the climate change is not on the tip of their tongue. Food is on the tip of their tongue. I ran into people the other day in social housing who were eating cat food, and I nearly wept, right? And they're sort of, I'm like, what are the big issues? And they're like, well, food, housing, well-being, pharmacare, healthcare. Healthcare is something that we have not discussed enough in this election. We have an aging population, and this is something that we need to address. This is something that Social Democrats brought in and that we're vowing to protect. So I think it comes down to sort of an ideological decision when we get into that ballot box on the 19th, or maybe you've already voted, and that's okay. Yeah, that's amazing that you've already voted. But when we get into the ballot box on the 19th, it's an ideological push. An ideology is how we want society to be structured, right? And how do we want society to be structured? Do we want to protect the well-being of people in Canada? Do we want to ensure that every single person in Canada has the basic means for a decent life? The NDP has stated this in the CCF before, and that's what I hang my hat on. And if you're with that, then I would love your support on October 19th. Thanks very much.
So before I start, I'd like to give a big shout out to the organizers of this debate. And indeed, I'd like to give a shout out to the organizers of all the debates that we've participated in during this election, because these folks are giving up their own time to do this. They are true Democrats, and they have dedicated themselves to providing us a platform so that we can face you, the voters. So I think all of them deserve kudos. Having said that, first part of the question that was asked was, what do we think is the country's most important environmental problem? And that threw me into a tizzy, because there's tons of problems and they're all important, but I'm going to go out on a limb and say that the biggest environmental problem we face is the ecological and scientific illiteracy of our political class. Because let's face it, right now, we've got a government of 19th century style politicians pursuing a 20th century resource extraction agenda with a medieval understanding of science and evidence. And talking to politicians, people have often asked me why I run for the Green Party of Canada. Well, one powerful reason is because, as an independent Green candidate, I get to tell truth to power every day, and no one can tell me which way to vote. And one of these truths
that we tell to power is that at least two-thirds of our fossil fuel reserves have to stay in the ground. It's a truth backed by solid scientific evidence, and the investment community is taking notice of this truth, and over $2.1 trillion that are invested in the fossil fuel industry are poised to flee that industry because of stranded carbon assets. You can tell this truth to a Harvard conservative, but guess what? They can't handle the truth. I had to go there. It remains to be seen whether Mr. Bonker or Mr. Trudeau can take this truth on board. And I've got to say, with all due respect to my colleagues here, the signs are not exactly encouraging at the moment. So if you want some truth, consistent, honest, science-based truth, supported by policies that would actually work, there's only one choice on October the 19th, and that's the Green Party of Canada. If you want a progressive carbon pricing policy that will help and not hurt low-income Canadians, again, there's one choice among parties, and that's the Green Party. If you want environmental policies that are based on respect for our poor, beleaguered planet and compassion for the people who live on the land, again, the choice is clear. And if you want a local candidate who's qualified and ready to bring these policies to Ottawa, I'm here to represent you. Because unlike any other candidate in this province, I study and research this stuff. I teach my students about this stuff. Evidence is my currency. So on October the 19th, vote for what you believe. Vote Green. You know you want to.